أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome back to Guiding Lights. In our third session of Guiding Lights today, we're going to discuss our third Khalifa, and this is Uthmaan radiallahu anhu. So like all the other companions, we begin by learning the full name of the companion. And Uthman radiallahu anhu, whose full name was Uthman bin Affan bin Abi al-As bin Umayyah bin Abd al-Shams bin Abd al-Manaf. And at Abd al-Manaf is where his lineage connects to that of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So bin Abd al-Manaf bin Qusay bin Kilab bin Murra bin Ka'ab bin Lu'ay bin Ghalib al-Qurashi al-Amawi Abu al-Amr. So it's the full name of Uthman radiallahu anhu. His grandmother was the twin sister of Abdullah bin Muttalib, which means that his mother Arwa was the first cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this makes him the nephew of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was one of the few men who could read and write from a young age, and he also had very beautiful handwriting. And because of his beautiful handwriting, he was appointed as a scribe of wahi. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received revelation, Uthman radiallahu anhu was appointed to write down this revelation that he received. And as he grew older, he became a businessman and he traded in cloth, and this resulted in him becoming very rich. And despite being rich, he was very generous with his money. He never hesitated to spend money in the path of people who were needy and poor, and if there was any person that was in need financially, Uthman radiallahu anhu would always help the person out. And because of the soft and kind nature of his, he was well respected and greatly loved by the people of his tribe. And he belonged to the Banu Umayyah tribe, clan at that time. And he also accepted Islam at very early ages. Now we know that when the people accepted Islam in the early ages, they were faced with a lot of challenges, because the early stages of Islam went through a lot of challenges and trials, the people who accepted Islam. And he accepted Islam when Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu preached Islam. So he accepted Islam at the hand of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And he came from the Banu Umayyah clan, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes from the Banu Hashim clan. And at this time, the two clans had rivalry with each other. And so he came from the one clan who had, and he accepts the message of someone from the clan who was at rivalry with each other. So we can understand that he was very clear-minded at this time, and he had no doubt in the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even though he knew that now his people might turn against him, which they did. They began to despise him and they turned against him, and this great love that they had for him and respect once before now turned into the opposite. And we said before that the people who accepted Islam in the early stages went through many challenges, like they lost their businesses, they lost their homes, their possessions, some of them lost their family members, their family was targeted, and some of them even were disowned from their family for accepting Islam. And Hakam was the uncle of Uthman radiallahu anhu, and he was one of the men who turned against his nephew and he began to despise him. So we see that Uthman radiallahu anhu faced the challenge of having his own family members turn against him. And when he became a Muslim and there was a lot of challenges that the Muslims of Mecca faced, he was the first person to migrate from Mecca. And he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for permission to migrate from Mecca to Abyssinia. And Abyssinia is in today's time is known as Ethiopia. So he moves to Ethiopia, he migrates to Ethiopia after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam grants him this permission, and he stays here for a few months. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says about Uthman that from my ummah, Uthman radiallahu anhu was the first person to migrate with his family, because he migrated from Mecca to Abyssinia with his wife. And he lives there for a few months, and he returns to Mecca when he is falsely informed that the Quraysh have accepted Islam. So they tell him that the Quraysh accepted Islam, and he returns thinking that there will not be any more hardships and no challenges once he returns to Mecca. But this is false news, and when he comes back, he returns to all these hardships and challenges that the Muslims are facing. Uthman radiallahu anhu partook in most of the great battles except for the Battle of Badr. And this is because his wife was ill at the time of Badr. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam instructed him to stay back in Mecca and look after his wife and to take care of her while they went out in Badr. And he did. He remained behind and he looked after his wife. Uthman radiallahu anhu has the title of Dhun Nurain. So Nur means light and Nurain means two lights. So why does he have this title? Let's look at why. The daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, her name was Ruqayyah radiallahu ta'ala anha, and she was married to a man called Utbah. Utbah was the son of Abu Lahab. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam began to preach Islam, Abu Lahab, who was a great enemy of Islam, he told Utbah to divorce his wife. So here Utbah listened to his father and he divorced Ruqayyah radiallahu ta'ala anha. So after her hardship of being divorced, she was granted such a beautiful companion. The Prophet ﷺ gave her in marriage to Uthmaan radiallahu ta'ala anha. So she was given someone who was one of the Ashara Mubashara, someone who was granted paradise, who was given glad tidings of paradise from the Prophet ﷺ. And when she became ill at the time of the Battle of Badr, Uthmaan radiallahu anhu stayed behind and he looked after her and she passed away. So when the Muslims gained victory after Badr and they were still on their way back to Mecca, Ruqayyah radiallahu anhu already passes away at this time. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam reaches Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he gives him the news of glad tidings of taking part in this battle, even though he did not. So he tells him that he will earn the same reward as if he took part in this battle of Badr, even though he did not, and he stayed home to look after his wife. And so she passed away before they could come back. And the Prophet ﷺ now gives him his other daughter in marriage, and this is Kulthum. So now Uthman radiallahu anhu, his wife passes away, Ruqayyah radiallahu ta'ala anha, and then he gets married to Kulthum, the second daughter of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is why he earns this title of Dhun Nurain, the man of two lights. Two lights means the two daughters of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. During the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, Uthman radiallahu anhu was sent to negotiate with the non-believers. And the Muslims were falsely informed that while negotiating, Uthman radiallahu anhu was killed. And this upset them greatly. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in particular became very upset at this. And he decided at that point to take a pledge that every person, all of his followers, will fight until their last men in avenging the death of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And so they do this, and everybody pledges to the Prophet that they will fight until their last man, and in this way avenge the death of Uthman. And so everybody pledges to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet uses one of his hands to pledge for himself and the other hand to pledge for Uthman radiallahu anhu, because at this time Uthman is absent from there. So this is a great honor, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam now pledges on behalf of Uthman radiallahu anhu. And this incident is made mention in the Quran in Surah Fatah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ يُبَايِعُونَكَ تَحْتَ الشَّجَرَةِ. And he says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with the believers who pledged under the tree. This incident happened under the tree. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of this incident in the Quran, where these people pledged to the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that they will fight till their last man in avenging the death. And then it says, فَعَلِمَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what is in their hearts, and he and فَأَنزَلَ السَّكِينَةَ, and he descends upon them peace. And the peace means that Uthman radiallahu anhu is not really dead. So these Muslims did not have to fight until their last man to avenge his death. So this is the peace, this is the form of peace that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descended upon him. So let's look at some of the services of Uthman towards Islam. When the Muhajirin of Mecca migrated to Medina, most of the wells in Medina belonged to the Jews. So the Muslims did not have free water. They had to purchase this water from the Jews, who charged them exorbitant amounts. So Uthman radiallahu anhu, remember, he was a rich businessman with a lot of wealth, and he always spent his wealth in a correct way, in a good way. So he purchased a well called Bi'r al-Rum. He purchased this Bi'r al-Rumah, this is well, from the Jews for 20,000 dirhams, and he allowed the Muslims to drink freely from this well. And at this time, this incident was such a greatly rewarded incident at that time, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so happy about this that he gave Uthman radiallahu anhu glad tidings of Jannah at this incident. And then the next service to Islam that's common by Uthman radiallahu anhu is a Tabuk expedition, in which it is said that Uthman covered the cost of one third of the army for this expedition. And he also gave a lot, he contributed a lot in camels and sheep with their saddles for these animals to be taken to partake in this expedition. And to this, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that nothing will do harm to Uthman after this because of what in whatever he does because of this action. This means that this action was so greatly acknowledged and it was so good in front in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he did not have to do anything else to earn reward. This was enough for him. But obviously, these companions, the Ashra Mubashara, did not stop at what, even though they were granted glad tidings of Jannah, they did not stop at what they were doing. They continued good work and they continued following the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So the next service to Islam is when the mosque of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam became too small for the Muslims, because now the Muslims were increasing in number. And the mosque became small for the Muslims. So Uthman radiallahu anhu used his money and he purchased the land next to the masjid. So now the Muslims could come to this land and there was more space for them now to perform their salah. And this was also such a great deed that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam already granted him glad tidings of Jannah. And now he already had Jannah. So now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam grants him glad tidings of a better place in Jannah. And this is so beautiful. Can you imagine being granted Jannah and then the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam promises you a best place in Jannah, a better place in Jannah? So at the time when Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu was being elected as the Khalifa, Uthman radiallahu anhu was present and he was also one of the first people to pledge his loyalty to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And during both the Khilafats of Umar and Abu Bakr, Uthman radiallahu anhu played a very prominent position in the state affairs. And we remember from our last session that when Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu was on his deathbed, he appointed a panel of six people, and from these six people, one would be appointed as the next Khalifa. And these six people were Uthman, Ali, Talha, Zubair, Sa'ad, and Abdurrahman bin Auf. And from these six people, it took some time before they could decide a Khalifa. And Abdurrahman bin Auf suggested that why don't one of us withdraw our names from this panel, and then we decide who the next Khalifa should be. And when nobody withdrew their name, he himself withdrew his name, and then he arranged something like a sort of a vote within these five people now for them to vote amongst each other as to who should be the next Khalifa. And at this time, Talha was not present. So Uthman voted for Ali, and Ali voted for Uthman, and Sa'ad and Zubair voted more in favor of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And when Talha returned, and Uthman was made the Khalifa at this time, and when Talha returned, then Uthman radiallahu anhu asked him, "Oh Talha, do you accept the position of being Khalifa or do you pledge your loyalty to me?" And Talha says that if all the people have already elected you as the Khalifa, how can I object to that? And this is a lesson for us, because being a Khalifa at the time was a great honor. It was someone who would look after the state affairs, someone who was the head and a leader at the time. And these men didn't fight amongst each other for it. They appointed each other, they voted for each other. And even when Talha came and he was granted the opportunity to either be a Khalifa or to swear his loyalty to the already Khalifa, he could have said, okay, I will accept the position, or let's re-vote since I'm here now. But he immediately accepted it and he said, Uthman, if the people have already voted for you as Khalifa, then I too accept you as the Khalifa. And in this way, Uthman radiallahu anhu was made the Khalifa, and his Khilafat lasted for 12 years. And from these 12 years, the first half of his Khilafat was a very successful and smooth sailing one. But the second part of it saw more challenges and was a very stormy second half of his Khilafat. So the people who wanted to create chaos among the Muslims now took advantage of the good nature. Remember, we said that Uthman radiallahu anhu was a very soft-natured person, someone with a very kind heart. So these mischief makers, they took advantage of the soft heart of his. And remember that Umar radiallahu anhu, we said that he was known for a bit of a harsh nature. And this harsh nature was not a negative, it was not used in a negative way. He used it to keep everything, the state affairs, smooth sailing. So no governors would now overthrow the Khalifa, and no one would come up with different ideas that would create chaos or mischief between them, because Umar radiallahu anhu was a stern person and he kept things in order. But Uthman radiallahu anhu was more of a soft-hearted person, and if any of the governors faltered, he would forgive them and sometimes overlook them. But remember, he himself, he did not go away from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or follow or do anything that was opposite to what the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. He always followed the sunnah way and the ways of the two khalifas before him. So as these people, the governors now of the different places around in the state, they saw each other becoming more bold and uprising in small ways, they also began doing the same thing. So much so that within a short time, the whole area had now become, people were uprising, the governors were being rebellious. And Uthman radiallahu anhu was a soft-natured person. And while all this was taking place, the enemies of Islam used this to try now to, as a point for them, this was something that they could gain power from. So Abdullah bin Sabah, he was a Jew. And he had at that time, he was a Jew and he was an enemy of Islam. And he wanted to mislead the Muslims. So he accepted Islam. So he came into Islam. And from here now, from within the people, he would create mischief. Because remember, if he was a Jew and he's creating mischief from outside, people would not, the Muslims would not accept what he says. And the Muslims would know that he is an enemy of Islam. So now he becomes a Muslim and he creates mischief from within, from the inside. He creates mischief and he makes false allegations and false teaching also. He creates wrong beliefs and he spreads these beliefs. And he earns more and more people who trust him and who come onto his side. And then he starts posing allegations towards the Khalifa. And he poses many assumptions and allegations. And one of them was that the Khalifa uses money from the state, which is the Baitul Mal. He uses state money and he spends it on his family. And this is not true, because we remember that he was a very generous person. And Ali radiallahu anhu stands up for Uthman radiallahu anhu and he says that Uthman is a very generous person and he's also a very rich person. So he's not using money from the state and he's not using Baitul Mal money. He is using his own riches and he's spending it on his family. And also what little that he earns from the Baitul Mal, he spends this on his family also. And to all the other allegations also, there was obviously an answer for the Khalif, that the Khalifas had against it, that Uthman radiallahu anhu had, and Ali radiallahu anhu also defended Uthman. And remember that these men would not be granted glad tidings if there were people who were unjust, and if there were people who would do things like use money of the state, because this money didn't belong to them. And if we can go back to our first session, we mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Tawbah, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوا بِإِحْسَانٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ. Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with Him. And Allah will not be pleased with someone who is unjust, who uses money that's not rightfully His. So how could he be made the Khalifa if he was a person with an unjust character? And how can the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam grant him or give him glad tidings of Jannah if he was an unjust person? So this is impossible for him to be someone who is unjust and for someone who cheated the people and cheated the state by using money for himself. So sadly, this group of people who were rebellious towards Uthman being the Khalifa now grew. The group grew and they would do everything that they could to try to bring the Khalifa down. And they would torture him, they would throw stones at him, and they would make his life very difficult. And Uthman knew about this. And he wouldn't do anything. And his companions asked him if they could go and fight these people who were against him. And because of his soft nature, he said no. These were Muslim people who didn't want Uthman as the Khalifa. They wanted someone else appointed as the Khalifa. So he said no, there will be no fighting and there will be no defending him, because he doesn't want the bloodshed of Muslims during his Khilafat. And this is so beautiful, because he knows that these people are after him, after his life, and after his, like, they just want to hurt him. But he doesn't allow his companions to fight for him. He says that whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed for me is what it will be. So he forbids them now from going and fighting against these people. And then it comes to a point where they want to assassinate him, and they try to kill him, and they surround his house. And they do not allow him to leave his house. They wait for him outside his house for him to come out so that they can kill him. So he stays in his house. And they don't allow him to leave even to get water or to go out and perform salah in Jamaat. And so he's stuck now in his house. And when the people see that he's not leaving his house, so when are we going to kill him? Then they try to enter his house, and they go to his house from the back. They jump over the wall and they get into his house, and then there's a struggle. There's a struggle between the people and Uthman, and one of the people who want to kill Uthman is the son of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and his name was Mohamed bin Abu Bakr. And it is at one point Uthman comes under the sword of Muhammad bin Abu Bakr, and Uthman tells Muhammad that if your father was here and he saw this, he would be very angry, you would be very upset. And to this, Muhammad bin Abu Bakr withdraws his sword and he leaves. He leaves and he's no longer part of this. But then someone else from these people come, and Uthman radiallahu anhu is killed. And he's killed on the 17th or the 18th of Dhul Hijjah. And it is said that when he passes away, he was in the state of fasting. He is buried at Jannatul Baqi in Medina. And from this, from his experience, we know from his story, we learn about how he sacrificed his life to save the bloodshed of Muslims. So he did not want that Muslims should fight among each other during his khilafat. And he rather waited until the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had occurred, and he was killed in this way, because he knew that this would happen either way. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had decreed this for him, then this is what would happen. So he did not want his companions to now begin fighting and make the situation worse, and then there would be bloodshed between Muslims. So when the news of his death reached the state, now the rest of the people and the other sahabas, there was great sadness, and a lot of them wept for days after this, because they had such great love for Uthman radiallahu anhu, and they all became very sad for a very long time. Let's look a bit at his character. He was a very pious person with high character, and it's said that his servants did not need to help him sometimes. So we know that these men had servants, and Uthman radiallahu anhu, he was a very soft natured person, and he didn't always ask his servants to help him. Some days he did things himself. And he would spend a lot of time reading Quran, and he would cry during the time of reading Quran. And he would cry at the ayahs of the grave. When the grave was mentioned, and when questioning things about what would happen in the grave was mentioned to him, this would make him start crying, and he would become very emotional at this. And even when he saw people who had passed away, when he would attend janazas, and when he would see the bodies of people who passed away, he would become very emotional and he would cry. And he would say that the grave is the first step to the akhirah, the hereafter. And if a person is successful in the grave, then he will be successful in the akhirah. And if a person is not successful at the grave, then he has problems for him coming in the akhirah. So from the other sahabas also, we see that some of them cried at Yawm al-Qiyamah, some of them cried at being held accountable, and this sahaba cries at ayahs that were mentioned about the grave. So this is very beautiful, because it shows the impact that the Quran had on the hearts of these people. Even though they were so spiritually high already, they still feared death, and they still feared the day of Qiyamah and being held accountable for their actions, and the torment of the grave and being questioned in the grave. He had great love for the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his life, and he adhered very respectfully to all his commands of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he upheld this right until the point that he died. He was a gentle person, and his character was good, and he did not take revenge from these people. He did not create bloodshed, and in this way he passed away. So he upheld this right until the end of his life. And this concludes Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The bonus sahabas we learn about today is Abdurrahman bin Auf and Sa'id bin Zaid. Abdurrahman bin Auf belonged to the Banu Zahra clan of the Quraysh tribe. His real name was Abu al-Amr, and he accepted Islam during the early stages of Islam. He accepted Islam at the preachings of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and when he accepted, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave him the name of Abu Abdurrahman. He also joined the migrations to Abyssinia and to Medina, and when he migrated to Medina, he became a businessman, and his tradings made him very rich. And he was also very generous with these riches, and he contributed to all the great battles which he took part in also during the time of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he's also known for his large contribution to the Tabuk expedition. He was also among the panel of six who was appointed by Umar radiallahu anhu before his passing away. And from these six, the next Khalifa would be chosen. But like we learned earlier, Abdurrahman bin Auf withdrew his name to help in the election of this Khalifa. And when Uthman radiallahu anhu was elected as the Khalifa, Abdurrahman bin Auf was the first person to swear his allegiance and his loyalty to the Khalifa. He passed away 32 years after Hijrah at the age of 73, and he is buried in a place today known as Jordan. Sa'id bin Zayd. Sa'id bin Zayd was the son of Zayd bin Umar, who passed away 5 years before the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received his first revelation. The father of Sa'id accepted the faith of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and so this means that he had abandoned idol worshipping. So Sa'id grew up in the household of his father, who followed the faith of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and so he was taught to do the same. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam began preaching the message of Islam, Sa'id bin Zayd at a very early age and during the very early stages of Islam accepted Islam from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was one of the people who could read and write from a very early age. He was married to the sister of Umar radiallahu anhu, whose name was Fatima. During the ending of his life, during the last few days of his life, he spent these days in a valley in Medina, and he passed away 50 or 51 years after Hijrah at the age of just above 70. So this concludes three more of our Sahaba. Inshallah, in our next class, we will discuss the remaining two Sahabas, and that will conclude our guiding light session. Jazakallah for watching.